Good morning and welcome to Jesus and You, which is the YouTube channel for Rehoboth Christian Reformed Church located in Bowmanville, Ontario. My name is John Wildeboer and I have the privilege of being the pastor at Rehoboth, and I have the privilege of sharing with you God's love. Our mission statement is to experience and to express the love of Jesus with everyone. And we hope that this morning you do experience the love of Jesus, whether that's through the words that are spoken, whether it's through images or the songs or the prayers, whatever it is that you need to experience about God's love this morning, this day, or whenever you are watching this, we hope and pray that you experience it. Not only are we invited to experience God's love, but we're also invited to express it as well. And so as we experience it and as we're filled up with God's love, I pray that every one of us just overflows with it as we express the love of Jesus with everyone we come in contact with as well. It's summertime. The weather is beautiful. I hope that you are enjoying it. I hope that you have air conditioning as well. We are already, it has already been 17 weeks since we last met together. There's been 16 weeks of online services as we have gathered together. And this morning I thought I would invite us to together recite the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed is something that has joined and identified Christian churches throughout the generations. And it was called the Apostles' Creed, not because it was written by the apostles, but because it summarized the teaching of the apostles in the early church. So I invite you to read and recite with me together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Will you join me in our opening prayer? Lord, thank you for statements like the Apostles' Creed that lay the foundation of what it was that you have taught through Scripture, through Jesus Christ, and through your word, and through the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we are grateful that not only can we know or hear or read about these things, but truly we can experience your truth and your love. We give you thanks that even though we're not able to gather in person, we can have the technology and the ability to connect at least with your truth. Even though we can't see and be with so many of the people that we love to see and be with, and we trust, Lord, that one day we will be able to be together again, we give you thanks that in the meantime, we can be fed and nourished by your word. I pray, Lord, that each one of us would continue in our daily devotions with you, whatever those routines look like. And we give you thanks, Lord, that we can speak with you, that we can hear from you, that we can be with you at all times and in all places. And so, Lord, bless us this day. Thank you that we can experience your love, and help us as we desire to express it more and more each and every day. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. it's Pastor John here. I'm standing out front of my house, as you can see, in front of our camping trailer. And I'm excited to go camping. Are you guys going camping this summer? I bet you're excited too. And one of the things I really like when I'm camping is to have ice for my drinks. So I'm going to go inside and make some ice. Why don't you come with me? Welcome to the inside of our trailer. As you can see, got a nice little fridge here and I can make some ice. So I've got a tray with some water and I'm just gonna open the fridge and put it in there. All right, there's the tray of ice, there's a tray of water in the fridge. I'm gonna close the door now. All right. I hope it's getting ready, because you know I got my got a can of 7-Up right here, and I'm really looking forward to drinking that with some ice. Maybe I'll get a cup. I got my cup. I got my 7-Up. Let's see if the ice is ready. Uh-oh. Doesn't look like the ice is ready yet. It's still kind of watery. In fact, actually, now that I look at it, look. The freezer isn't even that cold. It's not cold at all. In fact, the freezer isn't even plugged in. I guess I'll have to wait a really long time for some ice, won't I? When we have to wait sometimes, it feels like waiting forever. But the story that we're looking at today in the Bible about Joseph shows us that when we wait and we're plugged into God, then even though it still takes a long time, it's going to take a long time, even if I plug in the trailer and that fridge and a freezer to get cold and for the ice to be made, that even while we're waiting, God teaches us things. God teaches us things first about ourselves, that we can learn to be patient, that we can trust him. But God also does things around us. Just like if we were plugged in right now, then while we were doing other stuff, then that ice would be getting cold. The water would be changing shape, become a hard ice cube, and then it would be ready for what we want it to do. And when we have to wait for God to do things in our life, sometimes that's what he's doing. He's changing us and he's shaping us to be the way he wants us to be. And so we can continue to just trust God and wait for him. And so this summer, when you're waiting to go camping or waiting for your friends to come over or waiting to do something exciting, I want you to continue to remind yourself that patience is a gift that God gives us. And while we're waiting, we can trust God. Thanks for coming to my trailer. Hopefully soon I'll see you on the campsites. Talk to you later.
There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side.
There's no space that is love.
For our congregational prayer this morning, we have just one announcement, and that is a congratulations to Dorothy Hellinga. Dorothy will be celebrating her 90th birthday this Thursday on July 16th. So congratulations to you, Dorothy, to the Hellinga family for the many years and the health that God has blessed you with. Join us in prayer. Lord, thank you that your church is a family. And as a family, we gather together to celebrate and to comfort when necessary. We give you thanks, Lord, for the health that you have granted to each and every one of us, for the ongoing strength that you have given us. And Lord, when it is necessary, as we talk about today in our scripture passage, the waiting and the patience that we need to have. Help us, Lord, as you've given us an opportunity to grow in our patience. And help us to see, Lord, that even when it doesn't look like you are doing things, you are moving and active. And you are shaping things within us that we won't see or understand until later. I give you thanks, Lord, for the security we have and the comfort we have in our homes and in our country, in our cities, to be able to shop and to have all the required goods that we need. We have food and water and all kinds of good things from your heavenly fatherly hand. And so, Lord, we give you thanks for that. We celebrate with the Hellinga family that Dorothy could experience 90 years of your faithfulness, Lord. Great is your faithfulness. And we sing that song and we celebrate that goodness this day. Lord, for those things that are happening that maybe we're holding inside, and maybe we're holding them aside because we don't know who we can talk to, and we don't know or have an opportunity to talk to people the way we normally do. We pray, Lord, that we would know and that we could speak with you, and that we would use this time, Lord, to grow closer in our relationship with you. And so, Lord, may your peace and your comfort and your strength be upon each and every one of us. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, we pray. Amen.
Okay, we're going to be singing This Is the Day, and for this song, we're going to do an echo. So Michelle will be our lead, and everyone else join me in the echo and join us when we come together.
This is the day
when he
rose.
is the day when the Spirit came.
We are entering into our third message on Joseph. And we're going to be looking at chapter 40 this morning of Genesis. And when we left Joseph, he had just been unjustly thrown into the king's prison. And chapter 40 starts sometime later. We don't know exactly how long, but there were two other guys, a chief cupbearer and a chief baker. And the Bible doesn't tell us what they did, so we don't know why they were thrown in prison. But we do know that these two men were responsible to protect the king. If someone wanted to poison the king, one of the most effective ways to do that would, be through what he eats or what he drinks. And so the chief baker and the chief cupbearer were in very responsible positions, and something had gone amiss. And what ends up happening is, in our story, we begin to see what when we left Joseph, he was thrown into the king's prison. And chapter 40 starts sometime later. We don't know how long, but at this point, a chief cupbearer and the chief baker were also thrown into the king's prison. And it almost seems as if there's an investigation that's going on and some foul has been committed, but we're not really told the details about that. But in the meantime, these two gentlemen joined Joseph in prison. And these gentlemen were responsible to protect the king. You can imagine that one of those ways to damage or kill a king would be to poison them. And so through either what he drinks or what he eats, that poison could be administered. And so the chief cupbearer and the chief baker were in highly responsible positions. And our text tells us that they were assigned to Joseph while they were in the king's prison. And just to recap Joseph's journey, so far he was sold into slavery by brothers that hated him. And he was 17 years old at this time. He became a slave in a foreign country with a foreign language. And he worked his way up as a slave to become head of Potiphar's household, where he was then falsely accused, unjustly put in prison, and now he is sitting in prison, abandoned. But remember, Genesis 39 verse 21 reminded us that the Lord, through all of this, was with Joseph. And so in Genesis 40, we pick up the story in verse 4. After they had been in custody for some time, each of the two men, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were being held in prison, had a dream the same night, and each dream had a meaning of its own. When Joseph came to them the next morning, he saw they were dejected. So he asked Pharaoh's officials who were in custody with him in his master's house, "Why do you look so sad today?" "We both had dreams," they answered, "but there is no one to interpret them." Then Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me your dreams." So the chief cupbearer told Joseph his dream. He said to him, "In my dream, I saw a vine in front of me, and on the vine were three branches. As soon as it budded, it blossomed, and its clusters ripened into grapes. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand, and I took the grapes, squeezed them into Pharaoh's cup, and put the cup in his hand." "This is what it means," Joseph said to him. "The three branches are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your position, and you will put Pharaoh's cup in his hand, just as you used to do when you were his cupbearer. But when all goes well with you, remember me and show me kindness. Mention me to Pharaoh and get me out of this prison. I was forcibly carried off from the land of the Hebrews, and even here I have done nothing to deserve being put in a dungeon." When the chief baker saw that Joseph had given a favorable interpretation, he said to Joseph, "I too had a dream. On my head were three baskets of bread. In the top basket were all kinds of baked goods for Pharaoh, but the birds were eating them out of the basket on my head." "This is what it means," Joseph said. "The three baskets are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift off your head and impale your body on a pole, and the birds will eat away your flesh." Now the third day was Pharaoh's birthday, and he gave a feast for all his officials. He lifted up the heads of the chief cupbearer and the chief baker in the presence of his officials. He restored the chief cupbearer to his position, so that he once again put the cup into Pharaoh's hand. But he impaled the chief baker, just as Joseph had said to them in his interpretation. The chief cupbearer, however, did not remember Joseph. He forgot him. What we want to talk about today is that question about where is God when you don't see him? You know, it's easy for us to see God when there, things are good, and it's easier to see him when, you know, there are questionable times. But what about in those things and those times of life that seem completely unfair, completely unjust, or even harder, what about those times in life when God is silent for days, weeks, or years? What does it mean to wait? And how can we wait well? And Joseph shows us how to wait with patience, courage, determination, strength, and endurance. Let's go back and start looking at this story. And the first thing is remembering, of course, that Joseph was thrown into prison unjustly. And when Joseph, verse 6, it says, came to them the next morning, he saw that they were dejected. So he asked Pharaoh's officials who were in custody with him in his master's house, "Why do you look so sad today?" Now, it's interesting to me that even in the place that Joseph is in, he is still walking around and he is noticing other people. Did you catch that? He saw that they were dejected. How many of us, sometimes when we see that people are dejected or upset, turn the other way? We pretend not to notice. But Joseph, he continues as this man of integrity. And he noticed, he cared. And so he's going around and caring for other people. Not only that, he went up to them then and said, "Why do you look so sad?" His heart of caring for other people behind closed doors would open the doors to the palace. And the gentleman he approached said, "We both had these dreams, but there's no one to interpret them." Then Joseph gives us another clue about his character. And he said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me your dreams." Even in this place, we see those little hints that Joseph continues to profess the supremacy of God and continues to trust God in everything. And then Joseph goes ahead and he gives the interpretation. It's interesting that it's the cupbearer that goes first. And whether or not the baker had done something that resulted or was deserving of the punishment he ended up receiving, we don't know. It's possible that as the baker was hesitant to share his dream, but upon the favorable interpretation given to the cupbearer, he became emboldened. But either way, one of the things in the takeaways of this text happens in verse 14. Joseph said to the cupbearer, "But when all goes well with you, remember me and show me kindness. Mention me to Pharaoh and get me out of this prison. I was forcibly carried off from the land of the Hebrews, and even here I have done nothing to deserve being put in a dungeon." When we face hardships, whatever sorts they are, we are always faced with a choice. And the choice kind of lines up in two different ways. The first choice is obviously we choose to whether we're going to endure and just embrace the difficulty, which seems oxymoronic, but it's true. To be able to embrace those difficult times or those silent times of God is indeed such a gift. And so we choose to either embrace them or we choose to be filled with despair and frustration and disappointment. And I think a lot about how we encounter difficulties in life depends upon where we put our trust. And you see, in verse 14, it's almost a hint. Joseph starts to say, look, I need you to help me get out of this place. You know, when you get out of this place, remember me. I'm depending upon you, another person. I'm going to depend on you to do what you should do and help me out of this place. And how many of us in life haven't got ourselves into trouble because we were depending on other people to do things that we thought they should do? Can you think of an example in your life? I can. I can think of numerous stories and examples in other people's lives and also in my own life of places where I put hope or trust in another person, that they would deliver or do something that would be a good result for me. In verse 14, Joseph says, you know, when you get out of here and things go good for you, remember me, because I'm in here unjustly. Our other option is to continue to trust in God. When we trust in God, one of the things that ends up happening, that we realize that we shouldn't be praying for an easy life, for the easy out, but that we should be praying to become a strong person. And what God was doing in the life of Joseph while he was in prison, so he was continuing to develop his strength and his character. And we can look at this and we can say, how then is it that we, like Joseph, can wait well? The first thing is that we have to continue to trust God. Not to trust in other people, not to trust in our own perception of what's happening to us, because oftentimes we don't understand or see what's actually happening. But we need to trust God. That means it takes faith, because it means we're not going to get what we want when we want it. And it means we have to learn to be okay with that. It takes faith because we have to believe that when the time is right, God will give me what I want, what I need, and when I need it. John Calvin, in his commentary on Genesis, interpreted Joseph's 2 years as a lesson that nothing is more improper than to prescribe the time in which God shall help us, since he purposely, for a long season, keeps his own people in anxious suspense, that by this very experiment they may truly know what it is to trust him. If you're in a season of waiting, and I know many of us have felt like this whole COVID experience is a season of waiting till it is over and it's wearing on us. But this is also an immense and amazing opportunity for us to continue to grow in our trust on God, trust in God. Psalm says, do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Again, trust in him, and he will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. You see, we don't have to understand why. And those are difficult times because we so desperately want to know the end result and we want to understand why. But while we are waiting and waiting patiently before the Lord, God is shaping not only us, not only our character, but God is also shaping the circumstances around us. I look back on my own journey, even to get to the place where I am today, and I see how so many times there were places where we needed to take one step, and we didn't know what step two was, but we knew we had to take step one. And when we took step one, then step two started to become evident, but it was much different than we had thought or imagined it would have looked like. And as we took step two and then three and four and five and six, it seemed like a zigzag path that went all over the place. And yet, when we turned around and we looked back, we could say, oh, that's what you were doing. We didn't know it or understand it in the time, but God is in the business of character development. And part of that character development is helping his children, his followers, to trust and obey him, even when they don't agree or can't see the end. Second thing that God, that trusting and how we wait well, is to wait patiently. 1 Peter 2, verse 20 says, "For what credit is there if when you sin you and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if, when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God." I bet you it would have been nice for Joseph to have known that Paul was going to write that text thousands of years later, to know that when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God. Waiting patiently means that time is never wasted. And I want you to embrace that. If you're at a place where you're waiting for something and you're not sure when it's going to end, the time in which you are waiting and where God has you is never wasted. God's timing is perfect. Thirdly, endurance. Hang in there. Psalm says in Psalm 119, "It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees." Psalm 119, verse 71. When I submitted my profile to the denominational website so that other churches could look and see what, you know, what pastors were available and read about what they were like, in my biography, I wrote a sentence that says that in the most difficult time of my life is one of the times that I am most grateful for. In that time, when I was most afflicted, is one of the times when I learned the most from God about myself, about my wife, and about relationships. And those times of difficulty, as hard as they are when we go through them, they make our lives richer. They make our character stronger, and they make our faith stronger. And so, Joseph sat in prison, wondering what God was doing. And in a moment, his life was going to change in a dramatic way, but he had no idea. And he didn't know if it would be 1 month or 1 year or years, 2 years. But you and I can have the same faith and the same hope. And no matter what we're experiencing or going through right now, that God's promise that he would continue to bless us and strengthen us as we trust in him, and that he would reveal his plan, and it would be a good
and perfect land. Will you join me in prayer? God, thank you for this interlude of Joseph's life, this insight into what he was experiencing and going through. I pray, first of all, Lord, that you would help us to acknowledge in our own lives the times when we have depended or placed our trust in other people. And Lord, ultimately, our trust has to be placed in you. And so, Lord, we want to trust your timing, even when it's something we don't understand, even when it's things we don't appreciate. And we want to be able to embrace the place you have us in, to be able to ask ourselves, what does the Lord have for me in this place and in this time? What does he want to teach or to show me? And so, Lord, as we surrender our will to you, we are reminded of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who completely surrendered his will to you. And he knew what it would mean. He knew what it would mean to be forsaken by you. And yet, he willingly entered that place so that none of us would ever have to experience that. So even if in some times and some days we feel like that, Lord Jesus, we know that because Jesus Christ experienced that, we will never have to experience being forsaken by you, being left alone. But Lord, help us each day then to trust and to wait patiently for your goodness and your grace. In your name we pray. Amen.
My eyes have seen your glory, Lord. My life will be forever yours. Though I will stumble in my walk with you, your light will lead me home again. Purify my heart.
Draw me close to